Oh, yeah, the other, oh, yeah.
Poor guy.
Lily left me a message. Was she there?
To take you as a detail, you called them on that, right?
She said I went to somebody.
It's going to town meeting.
I think that was in the court before.
Yeah, we're going to town meeting.
What's that about?
That was selected, and then I thought it was going out of development.
Oh, yeah, she's with that.
Yeah.
February 5.
I'm afraid I told myself, we're not going to be able to get away from it.
It's just a review task. Yeah, we've been very pleased with the work.
We're paying attention.
So I don't have to do what?
I'd like to bring this meeting to order. And the first order of business is to approve the minutes of the October 9, 2014 regular meeting. We have motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Any additions or corrections? You need a copy of it? Alex?
Yeah, I have.
This is the minutes.
Yes.
Okay, we do.
No, it was somebody else's minutes.
Okay, a motion was made and seconded, all in favor approving the minutes. Any objections? Hearing no objections, the motion carries. The second item on our agenda is to receive a review of the town audit report by the auditors that will be presented at the February 4, 2015 annual town meeting. Sandra, would you come up here and sit here in that seat and give us the review that you had?
Sorry, you got me with a hat because it's too cold.
Right.
Okay.
Well, as you know, Sandra Wellwood is our auditor for the town of Salisbury, and this is her second year doing our audit report. Last year's was excellent. You did a lot of magic, and you helped us through a great year.
Hopefully a little bit more, if you want to just pass the penny another.
Something for you?
I tried to make a few extra copies. Does everybody have one?
I think one of you got one.
Give them to the board first.
I think they have them all.
They all?
Yes.
I got one.
You sure? Thanks.
I try to make some extra copies just in case. Okay. First off, for second year, good second year, of course, a lot more smoothly than first year, not as many bumps. There still are some opportunities for improvement, and, you know, we stress that. This year, I know it's kind of a transition year because of change in tax software and financial software, et cetera. But it's still important to get good processes in when you're doing that. Reducing funds is very, very important, and just reducing your risk as a board. That's our goal, reduce your risk, okay?
We want that.
Yes.
Where is the biggest risk?
In some of your funds, for example, my big disappointment this year was that the fire commission did not implement a standard system of bookkeeping. And there's a lot of money going through there. You've got several bank accounts with transfers going back and forth, and there's a lot of risk there, just because of lack of what we call double-sided, double-entry bookkeeping. And so.
Well, we'll make sure that that's followed up on.
Yeah, I'm hoping this coming year.
Right.
Plus, we end up having to do so much additional work, and it's kind of a guess on our part in some ways, you know, which is not good.
You don't like that?
No, no, no. So then it puts the risk on us, actually. But that, you know.
It is what it is.
It is what it is, yes, that's right. What we also do, which I take great pains in, is we change up our audit procedures from year to year. So what that does is it kind of doesn't make the auditor, the auditee get too comfortable and, oh, they're gonna look at this, they don't look at. So we switch it up. We do basics and then we switch it up. This year, we looked at Town Grove. That's another area I gave Joe some information. And Town Grove has the same type of situation in that processes are only good if they're followed consistently and they're timely. And I think there's opportunities there as well. So those are the two big areas. Of course, as always, my only complaint, to be honest with you, is I told Joe, kiddingly, that he had to be ready earlier when it wasn't so cold out. Because coming up, I live in Bridgewater, but even, you know, which is about an hour south, but coming up here in the cold weather is not my thing. That's the only complaint I've got. Everybody, of course, is very responsive and, you know, no problems there at all. Everything is pretty much status quo in the financial statements, except if you look, item two on my handout, there's new accounting this year for pensions. And basically what it says is now the amount of your pension liability that is not funded through investments has to be put on your government-wide balance sheet as a debt. So in this case, at June 30, you have your total pension liability of $965,874. Your fiduciary net position, which means what your net assets are in your investments for the pension trust, is $739,638. So you have a liability that we had to add to your books, mm-hmm. only at the government-wide. It has no effect on your budgetary or your funds at all. And some additional schedules, and I referenced the pages. And
is that the pension liability, is that unusual for a size, for a pension of our size?
What, that liability? Mm-hmm. It's actually pretty good. I've seen some that are only about 50% funded or even less. Of course, if you listen to the news, you've got a lot of business and governmental that are not funded at all across the nation. So I think that's good. I would never recommend that you try to fund 100%. It just would be a waste of your dollars. Yeah. Unfortunately, though, in some situations, it may affect your bond interest rates. But I think for your size in this dollar amount, I wouldn't think so. But you never know. It depends on the market.
Right. And that pension plan is being phased out.
Yes. Not soon enough, right?
Right.
Yeah, there's actually most of our client pension plans are what they call frozen. They are almost exclusively across the board going to defined contribution, getting rid of the pension benefit plans.
Joe, how many people are still in the defined?
About half a dozen.
Yeah, six.
And guess when you report before they're washed through the system, if I can use that terminology.
I'd say 5 to 10 years, depending on their personal situation.
Oh, you think that short time period?
For a couple of them.
Yeah, for a lot of them, yeah.
You're lucky.
Some sooner than that.
Yeah.
A couple of our clients are trying to incentivize them to move over.
It's already been all done. When we opened up the new plan, a lot of, that's why there's only half a dozen people out of 35 in that plan.
You got a few holdouts, huh?
Well, the people that were close to retirement or within, you know, 15 years of retirement stayed in that plan. Yep.
So that's that. It's a, you know, new requirement, have to follow it. Other item of interest I mentioned was the Town Grove situation. And again, some of that, you have little pockets of that same situation in other areas, but very, very small scale. Here and with the Fire Commission, you're talking, you know, substantial dollars, which is where you want to...
A little specifically, what are we talking about with the situation?
Well, what you have is, for example, you've got a cash register, a lot of cash transactions with no clear cut who's responsible, people in and out of the cash register with no accountability. Are they pocketing half the money? Very well could be, because there's no reconciliations being done. Deposits seem to be delayed into the banks. So does that mean cash is sitting in somebody's car? You know, that kind of risk over, you know, the deposits as well as, and then there's a checkbook out there, which we don't believe is necessary to pay for miscellaneous items. We believe you've got a process and a system here, why not use it, kind of thing. So those are just off the top of my head, some of the ideas.
Right, and you reviewed that with our comptroller already?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll address that issue.
We talked to the Town Grove people about this?
It's going to be addressed, all of them.
Yeah, they're going to address it.
Okay, cool.
So there's, that's what I mean by opportunity, as far as tightening.
But it's an opportunity, not, there's no...
Right.
There's nothing.
We're not aware of anybody.
Right, no accusation.
No.
That's right.
No, I want to make sure that's...
Just trying to...
It's only opportunity.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. It's, that's why I call them opportunities.
Right.
Yes. Okay, and so then I'm going to skip to item three. I did not do a management comment letter because it was pretty much status quo. You still have some opportunities from last year that still need to be worked on, and I understand why some of them have not even been addressed because of the change. There's no sense in changing funds or addressing funds and moving things around, which we strongly believe you should reduce your number of funds when you're going to be switching over to new systems. So if you're going to switch over, that is the time to juggle around.
Right.
Exactly. There's no sense in wasting time in this system when it's going to go away. Okay. As far as the, if you go to page two, I just want to touch on the government-wide, which other, unless you're going to bonding, most people don't care about, because that's full accrual, doesn't mean much to anybody on an operational standpoint. Two things I wanted to go through. One is, if you look at your total net position, which by definition is your total assets less your liabilities, okay, on a government-wide full accrual basis, you have unrestricted of $6,370,000, an increase of $981,000. That's the first item. Second item is your debt levels. Your debt levels went from $3 million, under $3 million, $4 million to just under $3 million, with a change of about $400,000 downward. That's normal pay down of your debt, normal annual payments, and you rolled over your ban at less than the total outstanding, so you paid down some of your ban.
And what does ban stand for?
Oh, was, I'm sorry, bond anticipation note.
Remember the money you brought in the bank?
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Acronyms. So if you look at that on this is a total picture. For your size town, what that's saying is you're in a very healthy financial position. And that's a good thing.
Because our total net position changed by an increase of over a million.
Exactly, and it's also a solid net position to begin with for your size. And your debt is, in my mind, you basically have no debt at that level. So that's a very healthy position to be in.
You guys can smile.
We haven't gotten to the end of the meeting.
But it's good to be in this position.
If we're going up.
Feel good while you can.
Exactly, yeah. And especially when you think about, I don't want to say you're a tiny town, but you're not a large town by any means. So, you know, that's healthy, because a lot of times.
Large in spirit.
Yes, that's right.
Expansive.
Right.
So that's good. I'd say, relative to other towns your size in Connecticut, you're definitely on the plus side of the norm, which is good. The second item on page two is your, what we call your governmental funds, which are all your different funds, your major funds, as well as all your non-major funds, including the general fund. And these are your fund balances. And if you look from 2013 to 2014, you'll see, again, you increased your fund balances. So what that means is your funds are stronger. Assets are greater than your liabilities by more. So that, again, is good. One thing I did change, if you go to the last page, that says page 33, this is nothing but a copy of what's in your financials. We changed this footnote so that it's easier to read and more informative. And what that does is it takes each of your major funds and your other, and it breaks down what your fund balance represents. And the important one here is the first column, the general fund. If you go to the assigned portion, that tells you what you have in the general fund assigned for specific purposes. For example, for your subsequent year's budget, $244,296. High school tuition, $256,406. And keep on going down so you can see what you've got. I like to use the word earmarked, what you've got earmarked. So this gives you, and this is it's always been disclosed, but more in verbiage than table. And I think the table was warranted here because you have so many different line items. Okay. The other important thing, going back to page two, is your unassigned general fund portion. And that's the last bullet on page two, where $1,297,647, and it's approximately 10% of your current year expenditures. That again is a solid position, and it's up from 9% last year. We have a few clients that are have been hurting, and they were down to 2-2.5% and really sweating it. Then we go the opposite extreme, where we had one client hitting 20%. And yeah.
Now, what is, you know, the Office of Policy and Management will stand between 10-15%. Is that?
Well, I disagree with. I can talk to you about percent because I know your size. 20% for Sherman, a client of ours, is fine. 20% for Oxford, a client of ours, is maybe a little too much, because you're basing it, I believe you need to also look at the absolute dollar amount, not just the percentage. And so to globally, across the board, for all Connecticut towns, saying 10 to 12%, I don't think is the right way to look at it. I think anywhere from 8 to 12% up to 16% is good for your size town. I would not be saying the same thing to Sherman, or maybe okay for Oxford, but I certainly wouldn't expect to see much more than that.
Now, the term unassigned refers to...
If you go back to that last page, that's just a page.
So it's not assigned to any one of these particular...
If you go all the way to the bottom, you'll see one liner that says unassigned.
Right.
And unassigned, by definition in accounting, can only be in the general fund unless it's negative. So you cannot have an unassigned in the Bauer fund as a positive, by accounting definition. An unassigned means that it's not earmarked for anything.
Okay,
it's available for use.
Yeah. Okay.
What is surplus?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. That's what we call it.
You call it, or some surplus. People call it, some towns call it reserve.
Yeah, reserve, surplus.
So we will,
yeah.
Fund Brady, balance is the...
Yeah.
But nor at our town meetings, we got to give the people some idea what it is, so they can understand. So these are our surplus monies.
In reading the minutes of all the different towns, I think surplus is the most common use during town meetings and during meetings. Yeah.
In other words, it's the money we have left over after we've paid all everything we have to pay.
And keeping in mind, excluding what you earmarked for specific purposes.
Okay. We've built that up over the years, and we started out, I think, at 6%, right? And one time, Joe, was down that low?
No.
It wasn't?
Seven?
No,
seven.
Seven. Maybe seven and a half, yeah.
When I first started in this business, I'm not telling you the number of years, years ago, the standard across the board back then was 4%. But now...
Well, everything's changed.
Everything changes, and...
Curtis has a question.
I just had a question in terms of bonding. Do we get credit from those who rate our bonds, the bond rating? Do we get credit for the assigned part? If we have a bridge line item that we put money into every year, and that's always in the plus column, and we have a bunch of those, we get credit for that when they consider our bond rating?
You should, because assigned is, by definition, something that you can in 5 minutes vote to unassign. But it depends on the bonding people.
Right.
Some are a little weird.
I mean, that's an
that
argument
kind of
some of us use when we say, you know, you have to add all those in. I mean, we're taxing people for that, so why go more than 10%? If we add those other things in, we might be at 12 or 14.
And that's the argument I would make with the bonding
right.
agencies, but sometimes they
right.
take
Well,
off.
It's been okay. I mean, they've given us good ratings.
The last time our rating jumped up, I spoke on the phone for a long time with them, and we went over all those other funds.
Right.
They were asking what our intent was and how quickly we were to use them and how long they had been there. So they do take those into consideration.
Yeah.
I think we got bumped up two steps.
Right.
Two levels.
That's all. I was just
yeah.
curious.
You should. The
yeah.
answer is you should
yeah.
have that taken into account.
I wouldn't want to live in a town where they're hitting you an extra 20%. I mean,
why?
Why 20%? What are you
so
going to do with that?
So we can be comfortable at 20%.
Yes.
I mean, even with the hurricanes that are going to be hitting us in the future.
Or the earthquakes. Yes. Well, my argument is always, and it unfortunately happened in North Stonington, where they had the bridge washout right in the middle of town. And you're talking $2.5-3 million.
Our bridge is already gone.
Oh, well.
Right. We want it to wash.
And they, you know, yes, FEMA covered some of it, but not immediately. And they had a rough road for a few years.
Yeah, they had to get the money right up front. And then they got back 75%.
70.
70.
Yeah. And, but the thing is my argument is the cost of a bridge in Sherman or Stonington here is the same as it is in Bridgeport, Stamford, or Hartford. So that's why I think absolute dollars have to be considered, not just percentages.
So you were saying between 8% and 12% for the town or side, maximum 16%.
You start getting into that over 16% to 20%, and I start kind of making faces.
So we're okay at 10.
I think you're fine at 10.
Good at 8, though.
You may have to go to 8.
You might be, you'd be fine at 8 as well. Okay. You'd be fine at 12. You do have to go there. Don't forget, though, that this unassigned has already taken into account your next year's budget estimate to drop it down. So you've got that $244. So you have to remember that that is already taken into account. Okay? Now, if we go to page 3, this is the important stuff, I think, for everybody. And that's your budget, your general fund budget versus actual. And on the first off, the budget expected to use $266,877 of surplus. And instead of using surplus, you actually increase surplus by $115,931. So from a variance standpoint, you're $382,000 better than budget. Okay, sure. Which is good. It shows that even though you were allowed to spend the money, you didn't. And I always like to see that, because that means you're managing costs, not managing to budget. Which is always good. I always love the departments that go to 99 cents below the total budget every single year, you know, for everything. I always question whether, did you really need to spend it all? Of course, as an auditor, that's not my business, but...
Right, well, we try to avoid that.
Yeah. Page 40 to 46, page 15 of your financials is a summary. Page 40 to 46 is detail. What I'm trying to do here for you is summarize those numerous pages to try to give you the highlights. So if we look at revenue first, you got a steep grant for $150,000 that wasn't budgeted. You have the LOSIP grant for $55,000 that wasn't budgeted. Your property taxes is your big budget item, which is the reason I put it separate. And you had a positive of $18,000 there. Conveyance taxes, $41,000 positive. And then all other, $12,000 positive. And what I'm trying to do there is pull out the larger variances for you. Okay? On the expenditure side, which I found interesting, your health insurance for the second year in a row had a hefty positive variance. Your Public Works, snow and ice removal, surprise, surprise, had a negative $26,000. Your Education Capital Reserve had a negative, but your Education All Other had a positive, and that's because of, what do you call that, transfer to?
At the end of the year, transfer from operating to capital of the grade school surplus.
Yeah.
Right.
So that was a decision that's a standard annual decision, so I wanted to show it separately to show what the board normal budget was significantly mm-hmm. under, and then you moved some of it.
Yeah.
And the balance of that is the high school surplus. The difference, that's why it's right. not
yeah,
dollar for dollar it, matching.
It's not for dollar, yeah. Like 18 or 20,000, I think. Was it?
Yeah.
16.
Been too many weeks since we did the audit. Then you have capital outlay, LOSIP, which was a little higher than budget, and the STEEP, which
what,
was...
What were the projects at the LOSIP?
Firehouse.
Yeah, we had to do a little more on the ventilation for the trucks down at the firehouse. That was right. That went over.
The exhaust.
I think that's most of it right there.
And the STEEP.
STEEP, I don't know.
Deckers was in there, wasn't it?
Yeah, but STEEP shouldn't, well, it's a timing issue, I think. I
yeah.
mean, STEEP is fully funding. There's going to be money left over.
There's going to be a surplus in STEEP revenues next year. This current year to offset these steep expenditures last year.
Unfortunately, again, accounting rules get in the way
yeah.
and don't allow us to record it
right.
as a receivable
right.
in this case.
But there's more than enough in the current active steep grant, well more than what we need. Plus, we're even using brownfields money. So that's not showing up.
We've already received most of that $200,000 already from the state.
Right.
So, correct me if I'm misinterpreting. So what that's telling you is what was received this year for what was expended last year will fall right to your bottom line
right.
and
mm-hmm.
increase your surplus.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right.
Yeah, steep is steep. I mean, it has to balance at the end of the project, and it will
but we also
more
have,
than balance.
So we're also going to be spending more money at a steep that we won't get reimbursed by the end of this fiscal year. So it's going to be, because there's always seems to be something in the works.
Unless you can get it.
Well, depending on the timing.
Yeah,
but a lot of those projects don't happen until the spring. So by the time we get the paperwork out to the state, they don't get the money back to us until after June 30th. That's a lot of the reasons why it looks like this.
But you take it as revenue if it's you get it before August 30th.
But they shut down. They shut down, don't issue money for the summer. We get no money from the state in the summer. We just get ready to get the paperwork in.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Other towns do.
We don't get it. We have got anything for the summer.
Is the steep the Decker Laundry?
Yeah. I mean, the total, we have a $500,000 grant. I can't imagine we're going to spend more than $250,000 total on everything. And plus, we have another $100,000 from Brownfield, so we really have $600,000. But remember, the balance is supposed to go into the housing component, the rehabilitation of Deckers. It wasn't just to clean it up.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't just remediation. There's going to be extra money in there, which they allowed us to allocate in the application for workforce housing.
Okay.
So we should be in the plus column by, I'm hoping, $200,000 or something to put towards that. We won't know until we start up again in the spring. We've got to clean the pad. There's another $50,000 or $60,000 worth to do, take out some soil. But we're pretty good.
Okay.
The building's gone, the site's pretty clean.
So, I mean, basically, that's it. So then you had all other, you had a lot of, you know, line item by line item, you had a lot of pluses and minuses. I'm, again, giving you the larger dollars, but it's all there if you feel like looking at it all, line by line. And that's about it. Nothing else.
Okay, so, thank you. So all our, you had mentioned that the, there was no deficiencies in the internal control over compliance, I'm just...
None over compliance. You're coming close in a couple of areas for me to define it as a significant deficiency or material weakness in some of your opportunities. But there's auditor judgment in that. And unless it's really blatant and I don't think you're going to take me seriously, I don't like to make it that, because what happens is it goes to the state. You end up being badgered by the state and answering state mandates instead of working to fix it. So I'd rather...
And we're going to do.
I have faith in you all. So,
so do I.
Who's the, for instance, where is this?
The
we went through it.
Yes, the fire commissioner. Yeah, they're close. Yeah. They're close.
But they're going to be addressed.
Yeah. So you should be, I think, very happy. I think that you know, good audit.
All right, well, thank you, Sandra.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
You're coming all the way out here.
As long as you didn't mind by half, we're okay.
Just remember, you're down where you are, you get greener in the spring than we are.
It's hot and humid, and you know, it's just terrible.
No. We're still in the winter when you're early.
Yeah, but you know, there is a significant difference.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. There's probably 5 to 7 degrees difference. And then if I have to go to Stanford, there's another 5 to 7 degrees from my house to Stanford, you know. So.
Call me then.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It is cool. I talked to my daughter down in Weston. I mean, it's, you know, there's a good weather pattern in ours, and then I put the people in Vermont. As expected, it gets significantly worse.
Which is like Vermont.
Or get me a call.
The sound has a real moderate.
When I was on the ski team in college, we had all of our races were in Northern New York and Western New York. And then we had the championships in the division. It was so doggone cold, the dance.
The dance? Yeah.
Thank you all.
Night.
Take care. It was such a dry, cold up north.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is to receive the quarterly report of the tax collector. John, should we do that for you?
Do you want copies?
Yes. No, we don't. Here, yes, we do.
Yes, we do. There, I got a couple extra here. Actually, I checked with Jean, and she says she's right on track, and there was nothing to report to the board. She's very comfortable with her position. There seem to be quite a few early payers this year. People paid their entire real estate taxes at the beginning of the year, more so than usual.
Wow. Well, interest rates are so low. What are you going to do? Try to remember to pay it again? You might as well pay it, you know, because of it.
That's right.
I mean, 0.0022%.
Right. And we have a motion to accept the tax
report.
Second.
Any objections? Hearing no objections, the motion carried. Next item is to receive the quarterly report of the Board of Education and any other updates from the board.
I also don't really have anything to report. We're, this report is through the end of December, so we're halfway through the fiscal year and 41% through the school year.
The only area of the budget that we are over on at this point is our upper building improvements, and that's only by 1.7%. Everything else, I mean, we're very happy with where we are. We really haven't had a lot of surprises or things come up since the beginning of the year, so we're very pleased with where we are.
Boilers working all right?
Hmm?
Boilers are working all right?
Yes, yes. This year, the theme of this year is clogged plumbing. Each year it's something different, and this year it's clogged toilets for some reason. But, but no, everything is, all the work that was done this summer is complete and...
Don has a recommendation.
Yeah?
Use single-ply paper.
Yes, right. I think we might already.
And then just use more.
So I don't know if anybody has any questions.
Any questions to the board secretary on the Board of Ed report? Everything's pretty much in line.
Yeah.
About 50% expenditure.
Yeah. I also included just an update of the capital reserve since you last saw it in October. Right. Not a lot's changed. In October, our summer projects were done, so we haven't done too much in terms of the capital reserve. I will remind you that Lisa Carter is in the process of working with members of the Board of Ed and our new head custodian, Brian Shippa, to put together a 5-year capital long-range plan. She's looking into having an architect who did the work for the middle school roof project come and do a sort of a walkthrough of, I don't know what you would call it, and kind of just assessment of the way the buildings are and if there's anything he sees that he thinks needs our attention. And she will use that report to influence the long-range plan for the capital reserve. She's hoping that she'll be able to share that with you when she does the first presentation for the budget for 15-16. She'll talk initially about that 5-year capital reserve plan.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Any questions?
No.
No.
Do we have a motion to accept the Board of Ed report, quarterly report?
So moved. Second.
Any objections? Hearing no objections, the motion carries. The next item is to receive the quarterly report of the Board of Selectmen and any other updates from the First Selectman and Comptroller.
All right. On the revenue side, on page 1, there's really 2 lines I was going to mention quickly.
Right.
There
were 2 lines that had big revenue.
$21.50 other. That's just, once again, that's some of that steep money coming in.
Okay.
For this project, so it's $98,000 of that is steep money. And then down under $7,700 other, that was the sale of the firehouse,
$210,000.
Right. Okay. $201,000. Sorry. Any questions on revenue?
Nope, those were the 2 big items. Stood out.
Okay. Jumping over to expenses on page 2.
Hey, Joe, can I ask one?
Sure.
It's not a big, real big item, but what's chapter 1 and 2?
That's just flow through money. That's money we get from the state that goes down to the high school to go through the pupil services. I report that because it's money, cash I have at the time, even though it's a wash.
Yeah, you don't budget for it or anything.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Going over to the next page then. The only thing I wanted to say on that whole page was the town report was roughly $5,300, and previously it was, I believe, $9,600.
Right.
So we cut the cost almost in half by
right.
doing it internally.
No, it was done.
So.
And it looked good. We only had one mistake. And
one mistake.
Only one absence?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It happened to be a Board of Finance.
Wishful thinking.
Was it too kosher? We forgave.
She's
left Carol Demetrius.
The one who was hoping for a new report. No good deed goes
unpunished. Do it.
Does anybody have any questions on page 2?
No.
jumping over to page three, there's a line 2040 police that's going to be covered by a grant that our resident trooper received. So that's of no concern, that high expenditure. And then down on 3030 snow and ice removal, last year at this time, we had $8,000 more in labor and $40,000 more expended in salt. But I just paid a big salt bill, so it's basically a wash at this point. That's one of the reasons why snow and ice removal is so low.
And the trucks were moving today, bringing stuff back from wherever it is they went. They were just as a caravan.
These little storms are nasty.
Horrible. The storm on Friday was just horrible.
They're going to have another one on Sunday or Monday.
Yeah, yeah. They little 2-inch with ice, those you use as much sand and salt.
No, those are bad.
Sometimes more than with like more
skating rink.
And then it freezes, and then it doesn't have to get rid of it.
My driveway's a luge.
Yeah. You just have to get in the tracks.
Right.
As those guys say, a foot and a half of dry snow, you plow it 2 or 3 times and then sand it once and you're done.
Yeah.
This is like
brutal.
Constant. Yeah, you just got to keep going out.
Icing the cake.
Any questions on page three? Nothing to comment on page 4 or 5.
What about other? Oh, I guess.
That's the, that's those are the steep expenses.
Oh, okay.
So total expenditures were at 40%. Is that like?
Correct. Compared to last year. And I didn't put the Board of Ed number at the time. I just wanted to say, I apologize. I had a little technical problem this week with my computer and printing, and I was just trying to make sure payroll and payables got out this week today. So I didn't get that number in there in time. I apologize.
Apology accepted. Any questions on the quarterly report of the Board of Finance? We have a motion to approve.
A second.
We have a second. Any objections? Hearing no objections, the motion carries. The next item of business is there any other business that is proper to come before the meeting?
We're working on a, Joe and I are working on all the projects that we anticipate. Some are really not even discretionary, like the weed harvester and things like that. And then some are, like purchasing the Polk property. And so we're gonna very soon have what that all implies, so that when we go to the voters to consider some of these things, you're gonna be able to describe what the impact is, if any, on people's annual taxes.
Yeah, it's a one sheet summary of what the projects, the total cost, what grant monies we're going to be have, what capital money we've already put aside, how much needs to be borrowed, at what rate, for what length of time. One page summary.
Right.
So we're pretty close to having that.
And we have some, we do have monies that are there already.
Right. The money set aside, yeah, that we've already set for those projects.
So we'll see what additional.
We're gonna take the high end of all these things, like the Route 4144 intersection,
right,
even though it won't be for a year and a half. The Amesville Bridge, those projects aren't bid out. Until they're bid out, we won't know. So we're gonna base our estimates on the high estimates, just to be on good footing for people, so we don't go back and say, oh, it was smoke.
Right.
So we can show all the projects as we proceed that the numbers will fall into place and be where they should be, so that there's always, everything is right there at every time we go to the public.
It includes the intersection, the transfer station, our share of the Amesville Bridge, our share of the intersection.
Weed harvester, current debt.
Yeah. Current debt.
And now the the school building roof project that's coming off in 2018.
It includes that as well, the timing of the other projects with that coming off in October of 2017.
And that 2+ million of current debt that she mentions.
Right.
Which is better than when we came into office, because it was over 5 then.
Oh, yeah.
And we've gotten a lot done. So. Right?
Okay, well, we'll look forward to that sheet, and then we will discuss how we're going to approach it.
Right. And we will have a busy winter and spring with little town meetings. And there are things that don't involve you that, you know, we're going to have to go to town meeting. Do we hold a conservation easement for the Salisbury Association, things like that? Do we take over Brook Street? That might involve you a little bit. We're going to P&Z next week to talk about some of these projects with them. I don't think there are too many with big financial implications. One is that there are a number of sort of projects back here that people are talking about, the diner, the dresser, the bonds maybe, and so it may behoove us to get some traffic engineering in place that has a professional look at how all this works, because we really only have 2 ways in and out.
Right.
Library and academy.
That's going to become an active area.
Hmm?
That'll be an active area.
Yeah. So, but that's not, I mean, that's our problem, not yours. So.
Well, it's not necessarily a problem if we address it correctly.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, it's not a problem. It's, most towns would love to have that as a problem.
Right.
I have a lot of options.
I know, they would. Okay, now our annual the town meeting to approve the audit report is on Wednesday, February 4th.
I gotta get you to sign that before it's
7:30.
Is it that's your spot?
You all be done.
We should, Joe. Can we get the Lakeville Journal just to put a notice on the front page?
Maybe not the front page, but maybe the
Lakeville. Picture of you with a paid-in report.
Right, the Lakeville section. Just a bigger announcement.
You mean pay for it?
No.
No way.
We public service.
They usually do, but they can put a little blurb into as a space filler.
We didn't put anything else on that agenda.
Right.
Even though we have a bunch of stuff for people to talk about, we're not quite ready to bring them public.
Okay.
Because we haven't done all our homework yet.
Right. So. And everybody has our meeting schedule, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because our next meeting after the town meeting is Thursday, March 12th, and that's to receive the initial budgets from the Board of Ed and Board of Selectmen.
March
12th.
Yeah.
Right.
Bill, could you send that out?
Yeah, but I can send it out again.
Would you? Because I don't remember if I put it in my calendar or not. I don't know what you do. Okay.
Can I make a couple copies right now?
Sure. I just made one mistake. I said
the
audit report for the fiscal year ending June 30, 2013,
Jim's
busy
2014. Okay.
I want to correct you now.
I'm going to be right on the 12th. But you'll survive.
Just 2 copies?
She does a good job. Anybody else?
Yeah, I was very
small. Yeah,
I'll
have
one in.
Don, do you have one?
One what?
The schedule.
Oh, yeah, someplace.
4.
I wing it. No.
Wait for the agenda.
If I don't like the agenda, I'm sorry. I'm out of town.
Do you
want a motion to adjourn?
No, I probably ought to.
We don't have anything else. Right? Any more
announcements? You know, you really don't need a motion to adjourn. You can just do it.
But we like
there's a different.
We have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
You have a choice.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Just going to bring that
we are adjourned. Thank you.